You're watching the Emmy award-winning Jim Heath channel on YouTube. Please give the video a like, subscribe to the channel, and give thanks by hitting the button below. Thank you for watching the Jim Heath channel exclusively here on YouTube.
In 1989, communism falls in Eastern Europe, and democracy finds a new beginning. But for democracy in China, 1989 is the end of a beginning.
Incredible violence, and I can hardly find any words to speak.
How do the people think?
We think that we should live peacefully. We don't want the army, we don't want gunshots and the fight. You know, army firing at the innocent people.
China, a country not much larger than the United States, but home to 5 times as many people, has been under communist rule since 1948. Mao Zedong, founder of Chinese communism, once said, "Political power grows out of the barrel of a gun." This year, for the Chinese, that proves to be true. In April, Hu Yaobang, the popular chairman of the Chinese Communist Party, who had called for reforms in the government, dies of natural causes. His death inspires students and intellectuals to demonstrate peacefully against the oppressive communist regime.
If you say the wrong word, you may be taken in the court.
It makes it very difficult for the Chinese leadership to persuade the intelligentsia of China that somehow the Chinese communists are different and they cannot let their people have it.
Demonstrations continue and thousands of dissenters pour into Tiananmen Square, a plaza facing the People's Hall and the portrait of Mao Zedong. Then, in May, Mikhail Gorbachev makes an historic visit to China, the first meeting between these two communist countries in 30 years. The official greeting for the Soviet leader is held on the airport tarmac, not at Tiananmen Square, where the Chinese authorities are embarrassed by the presence of the demonstrators.
If the Chinese leadership are clever enough, they should discuss with Mr. Gorbachev and learn something from him.
We strike for life.
It is reported that Gorbachev, before returning to the Soviet Union, remarks that he has little sympathy for hotheads who advocate overnight change.
We try to take the first step in the long journey to change the Chinese very unjust political culture, political structure.
Could this be a journey of 1,000 miles?
Probably more than that.
1,000 students go on a hunger strike. The number of people in the square swells to over 1 million.
The government failed to give the people much more democracy, and it is not a government by people, of people, for people.
Zhao Ziyang is the only Chinese leader who takes to the streets to speak to the students. Weeks later, the Chinese Politburo strips him of his position, indicating to the world that there is a power struggle going on with the hardliners, and Zhao is the loser. In early June, art students erect the 33-foot-tall Goddess of Liberty. She becomes the symbol for a movement that will not be tolerated.
No!
In the dark of night, tanks roll into Tiananmen Square, crushing vehicles and students. The battle rages for hours.
One of my students came back and left a note on one of my colleagues' doors, and it said, "Two of my best friends have died. Please go back and tell the world."
How were they killed?
They were shot by troops.
I can't imagine what happened. Here now, I feel I have a dream. I have a dream. I can't understand why some life just vanished a few paces from me. I can't imagine.
Some estimate that as many as 7,000 students are killed by gunfire, but no number is ever confirmed. The crackdown sends a wave of terror through the country as student leaders go into hiding. As the remnants of the democracy movement are destroyed, the government begins a massive campaign to round up the dissidents. This man, being interviewed for American TV, finds his picture pirated by Chinese authorities, who call for him to be turned in. A tip brings his arrest. Over 10,000 persons are arrested. 31 are executed for their crimes against the state. Tiananmen Square and the rest of China are restored to the old ways. But the spirit of the democracy movement will be remembered by the picture of one man standing up for freedom, now and in the future. In Poland, a 10-year struggle for democracy finally pays off. Solidarity's transformation from outlaw to ruler is a story that encompassed the 80s. A story of the struggle that finally forced the crumbling of the monolithic wall of communism and brought freedom to Poland. In 1980, workers at the Lenin shipyard in Gdansk formed Solidarity and went on strike for better economic conditions. Lech Walesa, an electrician, became Solidarity's leader, and he successfully negotiated legal status for the union with the communist government. But in 1981, fearing intervention from Moscow, the government of General Wojciech Jaruzelski struck back, banning Solidarity and jailing Walesa. For the next 7 years, Solidarity remained illegal, but still functioned underground. Then, in 1988, workers across Poland struck again. Seizing the opportunity to assert new power, Walesa convinced the strikers to return to work for the good of the country. And this time, a grateful Jaruzelski turned to Walesa to help him solve the nation's massive economic problems. Setting the stage for revolutionary changes, Solidarity wins major concessions from the communists when they meet at the start of 1989. They agree to restructure parliament to allow for Solidarity's participation and to call for free elections. In the June elections, Solidarity's popularity is firmly established. In a stunning victory, union candidates win 99 of the 100 seats in the new Senate. The communists are rebuked at every level.
He rallied the working class of Poland behind him, and they rose up against the ruling class, in this case, the Communist Party.
In July, President George Bush visits Poland and solidly backs the birth of democracy.
So I salute the evolution here in Poland, the reforms, the democratic changes that are taking place. And you can feel it every place you go.
But making democracy work is not easy. After weeks of negotiations, the communists and Solidarity finally form the new government. Walesa plays kingmaker by insisting that his Solidarity ally, Tadeusz Mazowiecki, be named prime minister. The communists acquiesce, and in August, he becomes the first freely elected leader of a non-communist Polish government in 45 years. Soviet leader Mikhail Gorbachev chooses not to intervene. Poland sets its course towards freedom, and a force is set in motion that will transform Eastern Europe by year's end. The forces of change are also at work in South Africa. South African President Peter W. Botha, referred to by many as the Great Crocodile for his autocratic and bullying style of leadership, resigns his post in August. In September, Frederick W. de Klerk is sworn in as president, becoming only the ninth head of government since the country was formed in 1910.
Frederick Willem de Klerk, do swear to be faithful to the Republic of South Africa.
Although regarded as a conservative, de Klerk surprises almost everyone as he moves quickly to reform the apartheid racial system that segregates and discriminates against blacks and coloreds.
Take note of what is happening in South Africa.
With de Klerk, the dominoes of apartheid begin to fall. During the September elections, hundreds of thousands of black workers and students go on a general strike to protest their exclusion from voting. After negotiations between black and white church leaders, government ministers, and the police, President de Klerk grants permission for a mass demonstration the next day in Cape Town, as long as protesters comply with the law. They do, and the peaceful march is one of the largest in recent South African history.
Our march to freedom!
Our march to freedom!
Is unstoppable!
Yes, sir!
Our march to freedom for all of us!
Our march to freedom for all of us!
Another sign of change takes place in Johannesburg, when public buses, swimming pools, and recreation centers are formally open to all races. Changes not thought possible in this decade.
Only if they test the bona fides.
Then, in a move which will be the precursor of real political change, Mr. de Klerk announces the release of Walter Sisulu and seven other aging political prisoners of the African National Congress, or ANC. All had been convicted of treason and sabotage and sentenced for life in 1964, along with ANC leader Nelson Mandela.
Brutal apartheid repression has failed to dent the mood of resistance among our people.
In December, the new President de Klerk meets with Mandela for the first time. And it is now clear that South Africa may begin relaxing the strict rule of apartheid. Nelson Mandela, imprisoned for 26 years, will soon be released. He will take his place as the leader of the long-suffering black and colored races of South Africa, who are finally feeling the winds of change blowing through their country. Washington plays host to a tradition of democracy. Outgoing President Ronald Reagan bids farewell.
And so, goodbye, God bless you, and God bless the United States of America.
I, George Herbert Walker Bush, do solemnly swear
that I will faithfully...
And George Bush is inaugurated President of the United States. Looking for a fresh start after 8 years as vice president, Bush outlines one of his priorities, working constructively with a Democratic-controlled Congress.
American people await action. They didn't send us here to bicker. They ask us to rise above the merely partisan.
Bush puts his stamp on the new administration by choosing his good friend James Baker for the position of Secretary of State. Baker is unanimously confirmed by the Senate. But not all of Bush's appointments sail through confirmation hearings. Former Senator John Tower is the president's choice for Secretary of Defense. But Tower's colleagues in the Senate are bitterly divided over his suitability for the post. The debate focuses on the senator's personal life.
I have encountered the nominee in a condition
lack of sobriety, as well as with women who to whom he was not married.
Give us in public your own view towards alcohol and whether you yourself have any alcohol problem.
I have none, Senator. I'm a man of some discipline.
Isn't there any decency left in the Senate? When do we stop the character assassination?
After a week of emotional debate, the Senate votes close to party lines to reject the Tower nomination. It is the first time in United States history that a new president's cabinet nominee is denied.
Oregon.
Bush's second choice to head the Defense Department is Representative Richard Cheney, who is quickly confirmed.
Well, thank you very much, Mr.
But the scandals in Congress are not over yet. Next on the hit list is the ranking Democrat, Speaker of the House Jim Wright, who is targeted for ethics violations. In April, Special Counsel Richard Phelan releases a report which concludes that the Speaker violated House rules concerning gifts and outside income in 69 separate incidents. Although he insists that no rules have been broken, Wright resigns.
Republicans, please don't get in your head you need to get somebody else because of John Tower. Democrats, please don't feel that you need to get somebody on the other side because of me. All of us in both political parties must resolve to bring this period of mindless cannibalism to an end. There's been enough of it.
And 7 years after President Reagan signed the Savings and Loan Deregulation Bill into law, which opened the door to fraud and mismanagement, President Bush signs an S&L bailout, allocating $166 billion over 10 years to rescue the nation's failing thrifts.
I pledge allegiance.
Legislation of a different kind regarding constitutional rights is at the center of two passionate debates in 1989. In June, the Supreme Court rules that burning the American flag as a form of protest is a right protected by the Constitution. Some Americans, maintaining that the flag is a sacred symbol, call for a constitutional amendment protecting Old Glory from any form of desecration.
I have three brothers that gave their life for America, so I can't take it when they burn the flag.
The opposition, whose patriotism is called into question, fears the consequences of putting any constitutional limits on the freedom of speech.
I still think you have to keep the right, though, of freedom of speech, and I think if some people, for them it means burning the flag, then I think they should be allowed to do it.
In a Senate vote, the amendment fails. And in another controversial decision, the Supreme Court upholds a Missouri law prohibiting public employees from performing abortions unless the mother's life is threatened. This is the first major Supreme Court challenge to the 1973 Roe v. Wade decision, which states that abortion on demand is guaranteed under a person's right to privacy. The Webster decision opens the door for individual states to create their own abortion laws. In November, Pennsylvania becomes the first state to place even further restrictions on abortions. Pro-choice activists who, according to most studies, represent the majority of Americans, step up their lobbying efforts.
Free choice!
When do we want it?
Now!
In April, half a million demonstrators march on Washington to reaffirm their support for Roe v. Wade.
How about the United States killing children? Our government is legalizing gay marriage.
But abortion foes are now much more aggressive. They expand a nationwide campaign, blocking the entrances to health centers which perform abortions. And in some cases, they turn to violence, bombing abortion clinics. At the movies in 1989, Driving Miss Daisy, starring Jessica Tandy and Morgan Freeman, wins Best Picture for its portrayal of the growing relationship between a wealthy Jewish widow and her black chauffeur.
the slower you go, the more you save on gas. My husband taught me that.
He ain't hardly moving. Might as well walk with the paper with
him. Tom Cruise plays a paralyzed Vietnam veteran who becomes an outspoken opponent of the war in Oliver Stone's adaptation of a true story, Born on the 4th of July.
I gotta go. I'll see you around, all right?
Tell me, what's wrong with me, Tommy? What's wrong with me?
Excuse me. Have you ever danced with the devil in the pale moonlight?
Michael Keaton and Jack Nicholson battle it out in the smash hit Batman.
You idiot!
Why do I stand up?
Robin Williams inspires his prep school students in Dead Poets Society.
I stand upon my desk to remind myself that we must constantly look at things in a different way.
In The Fabulous Baker Boys, Michelle Pfeiffer plays a sultry lounge singer who works the piano like no one else. In Iran, an era comes to an end when 89-year-old Ayatollah Khomeini dies. It has been a decade since Iranian students took Americans as hostages, embroiling the Carter administration in a 444-day vigil to win their freedom. Under the Ayatollah's rule, it has been a decade of war, terrorism, and Islamic fundamentalism.
I would like first to congratulate the death of Khomeini, as he was the most notorious dictator of recent time. Khomeini's gift for the Iranian people has been nothing but repression, war, destruction, torture, and execution.
It is certainly good, because it is the end of dictatorship in Iran. With the Shah, it was the end of one type of dictatorship. With Khomeini, it is the end of religious dictatorship in Iran. And as such, it is very good.
10 million Iranians crowd the streets to mourn his passing. Then, in a bizarre twist, the Ayatollah's corpse falls from the casket. With his death comes the hope of a new leadership that can steer Iran into a more moderate relationship with the rest of the world. Ali Akbar Rafsanjani is named the new president, and experts begin to speculate on Iran's future.
He is capable of taking quite tough, pragmatic decisions if he thinks it's in the interest of the regime to do so. He's not going to be blinded by Khomeini's commitments or by ideological goals.
Although Rafsanjani does lead Iran into a more stable period, Khomeini's legacy of state-sponsored terrorism continues.
Hostages are, for them, an asset in the bank. They're not going to get rid of that asset. They're not going to cash it in until they think the price is right.
In Lebanon, militant members of the Iranian-backed Hezbollah still hold as many as 22 people hostage.
It's a mixture of family clans, straightforward gangsters, and genuine religious fanatics.
In an attempt to gain the release of three Israeli soldiers held by the Hezbollah, Israel launches a successful but controversial raid into Lebanon and captures Sheikh Abdul Obeid, who is believed to be the mastermind behind many of the kidnappings.
Sheikh Obeid is not an innocent person. He is, for all intents and purposes, a combatant. In fact, he's the organizer, the planner of many of these operations, these terrorist kidnappings.
Then, accompanying this videotape, a warning arrives from the Hezbollah, claiming they will begin killing their hostages if Sheikh Obeid is not released.
Don't be late, because they are very serious to hang us.
Days later, another videotape arrives. This time, it proves the willingness to fulfill their threats. U.S. Colonel William Higgins, captured in February 1988, is shown murdered.
There is no way that I can properly express the outrage that I feel.
Israel refuses to release Sheikh Obeid to the Hezbollah, and no evidence appears to indicate that any other hostages are harmed in retaliation. Another legacy of Khomeini's rule is the death sentence imposed on Salman Rushdie, a Muslim author who now resides in England.
it seems to me that the religious leaders in the Islamic world act increasingly like a form of thought police. I mean, what they want to do is to be the only people who can orchestrate thought.
The controversy was sparked by Rushdie's book, The Satanic Verses, a fictional portrayal of the Prophet Muhammad. Many Muslims believe Rushdie's characterization is blasphemous. The Iranian government supports the decree, calling for any Muslim anywhere in the world to execute Rushdie. Rushdie immediately goes into hiding, protected by the British police. He remains secluded for years, another kind of hostage to Iran's mix of politics and religion. In 1989, Soviet President Mikhail Gorbachev watches the Berlin Wall come down and does nothing to stop it, abdicating 45 years of domination over Eastern Europe without ordering a single Soviet bullet fired. And within the USSR itself, Gorbachev is besieged by conflicts he has helped create, but now is powerless to stop. In his 4 years as leader, Gorbachev has encouraged a new openness that is now coming home to haunt him. In March, for the first time since 1917, voters participate in a national multi-candidate parliamentary election. Gorbachev sees the results of democracy and citizens' wrath over the slow pace of change. The nation's mood is reflected in Moscow's balloting, where voters elect Gorbachev's arch-rival, Boris Yeltsin, with an impressive 89% majority. Yeltsin's direct attacks on the central government will give Gorbachev headaches for years to come. But Gorbachev is forced to head off more pressing conflicts during the year, as ethnic violence and demand for independence increase in many Soviet republics. The bitter blood feud between Christian Armenians and Muslim Azerbaijanis grows bloodier. Both groups are seeking to break from Moscow, but the primary conflict is over their own disputed territorial boundaries. As separatist rallies grow larger and revenge killings escalate, Gorbachev sends in the army to restore order.
Gorbachev, to a large extent, has lost control for the simple reason that I don't think anyone, any politician in Moscow now, actually controls the situation.
In Soviet Georgia, ethnic clashes become so fierce that the army is again deployed to quell the rioting. Reports that chemical weapons are used against civilians are denied by the government, but local doctors point to the evidence. Then Gorbachev is presented with something completely different in Soviet life when 500,000 coal miners in the Ukraine and Siberia go out on strike for better conditions. Fearing another uprising like Solidarity in Poland, Gorbachev caves in and meets most of their demands. But the most serious challenge to Gorbachev's authority comes from the Baltic states of Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia. In August, 50 years after Hitler and Stalin secretly signed a pact that handed the states to the Soviets, over a million Baltic people join hands to form a 400-mile-long human chain to show unity against continued Soviet status. Now, all three republics are demanding total independence, and for Gorbachev, the threat is very real. Morally, these people feel they have good grounds to leave the Federation. But if he cannot harness the Baltics with bribes or force, the whole Soviet Union will fall to pieces.
The nationalities issue is going to be much more difficult to resolve. I mean, this is a country that needs to rethink again whether it really wants to be the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics. And obviously Gorbachev has a very big sales job on his hands.
Gorbachev hopes to sell his agenda at home by getting support in the international arena. When he and George Bush meet on the island of Malta in December, it is the American president's help he needs the most. These are the weather conditions they expect. But this is what they get, and the weather becomes the big story of the summit. Plans are quickly changed, and the two leaders are forced to meet not at sea, but on an anchored Soviet cruise ship. Inside, the atmosphere is friendly. Communism is being toppled throughout Eastern Europe, and the USSR is standing on the sidelines. Hoping to bolster Gorbachev's position at home, Bush now decides to firmly back his policies. Knowing that another Soviet president might be more repressive, it is in America's best interest to see Gorbachev succeed.
We stated, both of us, that the world leaves one epoch of Cold War and enters another epoch. This is just the beginning.
Back in Moscow, 2 weeks after the Malta summit, Andrei Sakharov, the Soviet scientist who symbolized the struggle for peace and freedom, dies at the age of 68. Sakharov's long battle against repression took him from a life of privilege to internal exile in 1980. Gorbachev freed him in 1986, and Sakharov went on to win a seat in parliament, where he continued to press for reform and openness. Prince William Sound, Alaska. A refuge for millions of animals. And a major stop for one of the largest bird migration routes in the world. But on March 24th, the Exxon Valdez, piloted by an inexperienced third mate, steers off course. The oil tanker strikes a reef and begins to spill 11 million gallons of crude oil into Alaska's waters. And the captain flees from the ship into hiding. 2,600 square miles are contaminated, threatening this one-time oasis of American wildlife.
Discounting the loss of human life that occurred in the events at Chernobyl and at Hiroshima, one can liken the impacts of the Prince William Sound oil spill to an Alaskan event of similar magnitude.
On behalf of Exxon, I wish to express our regrets for the any anxiety or inconvenience caused as a result of the grounding of Exxon Valdez.
Exxon's first active response comes 18 hours into the spill.
This should have been the easiest spill in the world to clean up. It happened in inside waters. There was no weather. It's flat calm. There's no wind.
I think that the booms and skimmers, if they had gotten on the scene in time, could possibly have saved everybody a lot of grief, but they didn't get there on time. We don't know why, but we intend to find out.
Frankly, it was just too little, too late, and they had too many excuses for why they couldn't do the job.
I also want to clearly state that Exxon has assumed full financial responsibility for the cleanup or anything that needs to go on.
In fact, Exxon did spend almost $2 billion over 5 months in what many criticize as an inadequate cleanup effort. After hiding from authorities for 2 weeks, Captain Joseph Hazelwood finally surrenders and faces charges that he was drunk while in command of the tanker that caused the largest oil spill in U.S. history. This environmental catastrophe leaves at least 50,000 birds, 2,000 sea otters and seals, and countless fish dead. Although Exxon's public image is stained for years, the devastation on the environment may linger for decades. Another maritime disaster shocks America in April, when an onboard explosion kills 47 crew members on the USS Iowa. The battleship was involved in naval exercises in the Atlantic Ocean when the blast occurred inside one of the ship's three main turrets that house the largest naval guns in the world. A Navy report later concludes that the explosion may not have been an accident. Later in the year, two of the costliest natural disasters in United States history take a devastating toll.
Evacuation. We're asking everyone, please be off the island by 3 o'clock this afternoon.
In September, Hurricane Hugo hits hard, bringing 135-mile-per-hour winds first through the Caribbean, then to the east coast of the United States. Half a million people on the American coast are evacuated before Hugo touches down in Charleston, South Carolina. Tens of thousands are left homeless, and the vital tourist industry is crippled for the coming season. And Hugo leaves behind over $4 billion in property damage.
The gods are on it, on our side. They are. I believe it.
But there are no early warnings for a natural disaster in San Francisco 1 month later. As 60,000 fans pile into Candlestick Park for the third game of the World Series between the San Francisco Giants and neighboring Oakland Athletics, ABC sportscasters are in the midst of their pregame show.
Second base, so the Oakland A's take a... I'll tell you what, we're having an earthquake.
The earthquake lasts 15 seconds, and the players and fans at Candlestick are shaken up, but okay. The World Series is postponed. But just a few miles away, the quake is taking a horrible toll. It is 4 minutes after 5 p.m., at the height of the rush hour, and the earthquake, measuring 7.1 on the Richter scale, collapses a one-mile section of the Nimitz Freeway in Oakland, crushing cars and passengers.
Store water, prepare for aftershocks, prepare for 3 days of no services. You got 90 minutes of light left. You better make use of your time.
Buildings constructed on landfill collapse. Ruptured gas lines cause raging fires. In the end, the quake leaves behind $6 billion in damage. 62 people are dead. Baseball immortal Pete Rose, nicknamed Charlie Hustle during his rookie year, went on to become the game's all-time leader in hits. In 1989, as manager of the Cincinnati Reds, Rose is hit with a 225-page report that charges him with betting heavily on baseball and on games involving the Reds. During 6 months of investigations and court hearings, Rose consistently denies the allegations.
I'm happy to look in the camera now and say I never bet on baseball and I never bet on Cincinnati Red baseball.
But in August, Baseball Commissioner A. Bartlett Giamatti bans Pete Rose from the game.
The matter of Mr. Rose is now closed. It will be debated and discussed. Let no one think that it did not hurt baseball.
On December 16th, U.S. Armed Forces invade Panama and bring to an end the 7-year dictatorship of Manuel Antonio Noriega. But the beginning of the end for Noriega occurred a year and a half earlier when he was charged with drug trafficking.
A 12-count indictment was returned by a Miami federal grand jury charging General Manuel Antonio Noriega, commander-in-chief of the Defense Forces of the Republic of Panama, and 15 other defendants with federal narcotics violations.
Panama is a country of strategic importance to the United States because of the Panama Canal. Manuel Noriega became dictator after the death of Omar Torrijos in 1981. In order to enforce order, Noriega used his Dignity Battalion, a personal paramilitary police force. Over the years, he also allegedly became involved in the trafficking of drugs to the United States. The indictment of Noriega in 1988 initiated a sequence of events that would eventually bring him down in 1989. Economic sanctions were imposed on Panama in order to bring pressure on Noriega to step aside. Coups were attempted and foiled. Noriega stood defiant. Then, in May of 1989, confident of a win, he allows elections to be held. U.S. observers, led by former President Jimmy Carter, arrive to ensure fair elections. What they find is fraud.
The military, Joe Noriega and his aides, decided to steal the election and not let the true returns be known.
We have our own way of life. We have our own democracy. We have our own style of democracy.
Noriega disavows the observers' claims that Guillermo Endara is the landslide winner.
The people won, we won, the Ado Civilista won by a vote of 70 or 75% of the voters.
And Noriega condones the public beatings of opposition candidates. The people of Panama then take to the streets.
I hope he's watching, because this is like telling him, you know, get the hell out.
In October, another coup is attempted, this time by one of Noriega's top officers, Major Moises Heraldi. It fails when Noriega talks Heraldi into releasing him. In December, Noriega takes a step that many consider incredible. He declares war on the United States. In the wake of the failed coup, and because of the defiance shown by Noriega towards the United States, President Bush finally makes his move and launches Operation Just Cause.
As president, I have no higher obligation than to safeguard the lives of American citizens. And that is why I directed our armed forces to protect the lives of American citizens in Panama and to bring General Noriega to justice in the United States.
5 days before Christmas, U.S. soldiers begin a night invasion of Panama City. Guillermo Endara is now sworn in as president. But Noriega manages to escape the invading forces and remains hidden for days.
He's a crafty devil, as you know. He grew up in a very tough academy, so he's been used to this for many years.
Battles continue in the streets as U.S. Marines root out pockets of resistance. Then, on Christmas Eve, Noriega arrives at the Vatican Embassy in Panama City and seeks asylum. Troops surround the embassy and try to convince the papal nuncio to release him to U.S. custody. Soldiers blast rock music through loudspeakers, hoping that it will cause discomfort in the embassy and flush Noriega out. Then, 10 days after taking refuge, Noriega agrees to give himself up. He is handed over to drug enforcement agents, who place him in a Florida jail to await trial. The cost of the invasion is high. In civilians killed, and in the destruction left behind. But nearly a decade of dictatorship is over.
I'm delighted that I have left something. I mean, you can go through your whole life and never leave anything behind.
Fasten your seatbelts. It's going to be a bumpy night.
Since this earth affords no joy to me, but to command, to check, to order such as are of better person than myself, I'll make my heaven to dream.
Oh, how I hate to get up in the morning. Oh, how I'd love to remain in bed.
Thank you.
Mr. Teller. That was violence on television, not violins. Violence.
Oh, well, that's different.
Yes.
Never mind.
I love the game. I care deeply about the game. And I am first and last a fan.
A turbulent decade nears its end. But the drama of the 80s will be magnified in its closing months when Moscow's domination over Eastern Europe collapses like a house of cards. The countries of Hungary, East Germany, Czechoslovakia, Romania, and Bulgaria, Soviet satellites for 45 years, are all witnessing popular movements for reform and free elections. And the USSR, which in the past responded to revolt by sending in troops and tanks, is now moving in the opposite direction by actually reducing its military presence. The lightning speed of communism's demise takes everyone by surprise. It is a story with many chapters and characters, but its theme is a simple one of people yearning to be free. In Hungary, the Iron Curtain shows its first signs of collapse in May. The communist world is shocked when soldiers begin dismantling the 150-mile barbed wire fence separating Hungary from neutral Austria. It's the first physical barrier of totalitarianism to crumble. For months, East German citizens have been using Hungary as an escape route to the West. Now, with the new openness in Hungary, tens of thousands of East Germans swarm the West German embassy in Budapest, hoping that this roundabout route will lead to freedom. Despite angry warnings from the East German government, Hungary grants safe haven to the refugees. East Germans continue to flee repressive life at home, and Mikhail Gorbachev does nothing to stop the exodus. East Germany is hemorrhaging. And after months of negotiation, the Hungarian government announces the fate of its East German refugees. They are granted free passage to the West.
Wunderbar, super, ganz super.
In October, Gorbachev travels to Berlin to help East German strongman Erich Honecker commemorate the 40th anniversary of the Communist Party's domination. Ironically, this grand celebration of communism's heritage will be the country's last. The Soviet leader makes it clear that East Germany's problems will have to be solved at home.
It is now clear that the Soviet Union hasn't got the power or the willpower to actually intervene in Eastern Europe and shape events in Eastern Europe. So therefore, the days when the Soviet Union could be run from Moscow, the days when Eastern Europe could be run from Moscow are over.
Demonstrations are spreading throughout East Germany and to other Eastern Bloc countries. In Czechoslovakia, 10,000 demonstrators gather to call for democratic reform, but are dispersed with clubs and tear gas. But they return, now by the hundreds of thousands. Within a month, the communist regime resigns and is replaced by Alexander Dubček, the reformer who led the Prague Spring Revolt of 1968, and Václav Havel, the dissident playwright who will become president of the country. In Hungary, they hold their first free election in 40 years. The world rejoices with the people of Hungary as their nation is proclaimed a free republic.
1989, October
23. In East Germany, the Berlin Wall has separated a people for 28 years. But now the reality of change is at hand. The old guard, led by Erich Honecker, is swept away. All travel restrictions are lifted, and now crowds begin to gravitate to the Berlin Wall, that hated symbol of repression and separation. Soon, masses are gathering in celebration. Then, the Berlin Wall begins to crumble.
I never believed that it will really happen, that this wall will broken down.
But next door, in Romania, one of the most repressive regimes in Europe, the people's desire for democracy is strong, but the forces in power do not give up without a fight. During a speech by Romania's dictator, Nicolae Ceausescu, thousands of people begin shouting pro-democracy slogans. Then, Ceausescu's loyal Securitate forces open fire on the crowd. The next day, as many as 150,000 protesters mass in University Square to battle Securitate troops. Ceausescu and his wife flee the capital, but they are tracked down by Romanians seeking revenge for the hardships imposed by his rigid regime. Revenge comes for the people of Romania on Christmas Day, when the Ceausescus are secretly tried and executed. Romanians revel in their victory. But their success is bittersweet. It is estimated that 60,000 Romanians lost their lives in the uprising. Their road to freedom is stained in blood. But for most people in Eastern Europe, the 80s come to a close in joyous celebration. And for people around the world, this banner from the Berlin Wall is a symbol of hope for the future.
You're watching the Emmy Award-winning Jim Heath channel on YouTube. Please give the video a like, subscribe to the channel, and give thanks by hitting the button below. Thank you for watching the Jim Heath Channel exclusively here on YouTube.